Hello and welcome back to Book Lust. I'm Nancy Pearl. My guest today at University Bookstore is writer Adam Haslett. Adam, so nice to meet you. Big fan.
Thanks for having me here. Good to be here.
So I want to start with something that I don't think we've ever really talked about on this show in all the years that we've been doing it. If I hadn't been a fan already of your books, your first novel, Union Atlantic, and then your collection of short stories, I would have picked up your new book, Imagine Me Gone, because of the cover. Mm-hmm. And the cover is brilliant is the only word. Is that how you felt? I mean, how many covers did they show you before you?
Well, it's interesting. It's the first cover they showed me. Really? And they were all very enthusiastic about it. And there are two things about it for me that I was really excited about. One is that, because it's my favorite cover of all
yes.
the books I've had. And because I'm a writer, I work in text. And so the fact that the designer was able to create emotion and a sense of emotion that was so apt for the book just within the text was exciting because there wasn't a photograph telling you what you ought to feel about
it.
And then the second thing is there's a lot of music in the book. And one of the main, a lot of British new wave and various kinds of music. And one of the bands that's often referred to as New Order, and this typeface is the typeface of New Order's first album.
Wow.
And so if you see the full cover with the missing letters on the back of the book, that whole total design looks very much like a New Order or Joy Division album. And so that was particularly satisfying because, you know, of course, I've always wanted my own New Order album, and there
yeah,
it was.
Yeah, and there it was.
Yeah.
I just think the person who designed it should get an award.
Keith Hayes from Little Brown.
I mean, gosh. And you're right, it absolutely captures the book, the theme of the book and mm-hmm. the sorrow at the heart of the book.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, even knowing that, you're just compelled to open the book and see what those missing letters are doing inside.
No, I was very happy with it myself.
So what was the impetus for this particular book?
Yeah, well, there was there's a scene that comes towards the end of the book between two brothers. So it's the story of a family, five members of the family, told over about 35 or 40 years. And as a friend of mine recently put it, it's sort of like a love story about a family, because it's a family that loves each other a great deal, and they're struggling through the suffering of a couple of members of their family. And the germ of it was that I had a vision of this scene between these two brothers that comes at the end of the book. And I wasn't sure, I knew I had to write that scene.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't sure whether I was going to do it as a short story and you would just learn enough to get there.
Mm-hmm.
But then I also had this idea of the mother at the beginning of the book when she's taking the family, when the kids are still small, up to Maine. And those became the kind of bookends of it,
mm-hmm.
that I decided I'm really going to tell the whole story. You're going to
mm-hmm.
find out exactly why they're in that cabin and the everything in their lives, or you know, as much as you can get into a novel, that led to them being there.
At what point did you decide? Because one of the very interesting parts about the novel, and one of the things that to me made it work so well, is that the narration alternates among those five people: the father, the mother, the two brothers, and a sister.
Yeah.
When did that decision come?
Well, I think my last novel I'd written all in third person,
uh-huh.
the whole book, and I'm a slow writer, so it was like, you know, 5 years of that. And by the time I finished that book, I'm like, I don't want to write in the third person. I want to be in voice.
Uh-huh.
And then it just also made sense because it is a portrait of the family that's, they don't narrate the same events. They kind of move forward chronologically.
Right.
But I wanted to, and some of these things you don't realize until you're finished with it.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things I realized when I was finished was that the way that we see other members of our family is in some sense narrow or less than, or different than how they see themselves out in the world and how mm-hmm. other people see them. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to capture that sense of how that original sense of how we see someone in a family affects how we deal with them throughout their lives, the ways that we try to help them, mm-hmm. the ways we need them to be a certain person. Mm-hmm. And so I couldn't
for our needs.
For our needs, yeah, right? And so even the way we try to help people sometimes is derived from what we need them to be for us.
Right.
And I wouldn't have been able to get at that if I hadn't really had this, you step into one character and then you see them again from a different point of view.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing that I thought was very interesting with those five characters that are telling this story over a period of four decades
yeah.
or so, is that each different narrator moves the story forward.
Yeah.
Years or
right.
some period of time.
Yeah. I had to spend, yeah, one of that was the, technically, I think the thing that I spent the most time trying to work out was how to make that time move forward without it really being anybody stepping out of the narrative to kind of speak
right.
to the reader about it. And 10 years later, we did this. I mean,
right.
because I'm always inside the head of the characters, and I want to be, I mean, my goal whenever I write is to try to get as far inside the texture and nuance of that person's life, which I'm doing often with the kind of the rhythm of the language, because I had to adapt and discover different rhythms in the prose for each of these five characters to kind of distinguish them.
The main character, Michael, suffers from mental illness, from anxiety, depression.
Yeah.
And I imagine that must have been extremely difficult, or was it freeing in a way to inhabit him
yeah.
as fully as you do?
Yeah. Well, the task there, and as you know, his sections are slightly different than the other sections because
yes.
he takes various forms, like a doctor's intake form or you know
the diary on the boat.
The diary on the boat, the letters to
yes.
his relative.
Right.
You know, and he parodies things. So yeah. he speaks somewhat indirectly to the reader by these things that the reader gets a sense are over the top. And that, for me, was a way to get at the frenetic,
uh-huh.
frantic energy that he
right.
had,
right.
As well as some of the humor. But that the reader knows and senses as they do that, as they read through that, that not all is well.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think in terms of inhabiting it, I needed to find a rhythm that was going to communicate all those things.
Mm-hmm.
And I came upon those forms as a way to do it. And that was liberating
mm-hmm.
because it was a very generative voice that suggested more of itself.
Yeah, I mean the letters, Michael's sections are just wonderful. Wonderful and scary and sad, terribly sad to read, because you get a sense of his, of the struggle he's having.
Yeah, yeah.
But you don't, but when you read the letters, and the ship is taking the family from the United States to England, where the father
yeah.
was from, and they're gonna live there, and everything is gonna be fine. And that's early in the book when the children are relatively young, and Michael's letters to his aunt from the ship, you sort of sense that something isn't right, but you don't really pick up on everything until you read much further.
Yeah, I mean that is one of the things also that the speaking about the dynamics in the family of how the family perceives slowly what's happening mm-hmm. with Michael, and the father perceives it before, earlier, mm-hmm. because he himself
right.
suffers in depression and he has this intuition about his son. You know, there, it's funny because mental illness is this phrase that we use that in some ways is kind of like a conceptual suitcase that we sort of open up and pour in a lot of things that we don't really want to think about, and then we close
right.
the suitcase again. And my goal is always to just put the reader inside the mind, and there's a lot of absurdity and humor and hilarity that goes along with some of the energies
right.
that are involved, and this is true obviously with lots of creative people as well, of of mental suffering. Mm-hmm. So I don't, I'm not trying to give a clinical explanation or description, right?
Of course.
It's and who among us hasn't been in some of these states at some point? But in a novel, you inhabit someone, you know, you can inhabit someone where that's a predominant fact.
How did you settle upon the title, Imagine Me Gone?
There again, I had some help. I have a great editor at A Little Brown, Ben George, and I had a list of 40 titles 24 hours before I had to decide what the title of the book was. So I was in a bit of a pickle. And he had put Imagine Me Gone on the list because it's a phrase in the book.
That the father uses.
That the father uses early in the book.
Right.
And he's saying it in a way that doesn't, it has an echo once you read it with the title of the book, but he's saying somewhat practically. He's taking his kids out on a boat and he's imagining, telling them that they need to think about what they would do in a kind of boat accident situation. So I really would say others chose it for me. I mean, he found the phrase, and then people were enthusiastic about it, and now I feel like I've adopted it and it's mine.
Yeah, right.
You know, but I can't say that I came up with it.
Can't take all the credit for it.
No.
So your first book, as I mentioned, is Union Atlantic, and it's a novel with some of the same themes. Are those your themes?
Well, I mean, I think
how would you?
Yeah, I think people in states of extremis, often internally, have always been, I guess, my concern in some way. I mean, it's true in the short stories. But also, I think, and again, you only see this in retrospect, it's the people, it's how people who are suffering mentally and psychically, then how that reverberates in a family, in other relationships, in
a larger community.
And so I think it's true, the old adage that you don't choose your material chooses you. And so, you know, there's been mental illness in my family, and this was not a subject I just Googled. So it's something that is of concern to me. And certainly this book, the new book, Imagine Me Gone, feels like kind of the book I had to write that was, in a way, a culmination of that particular interest or need to express.
You have, in Imagine Me Gone, there are two women, a mother and a daughter, main characters. There are minor female characters. And in Union Atlantic, one of the main characters is a woman as well.
Yeah.
And you do those women quite well, don't you think? I think that that's what writing is to inhabit another person, whatever, you know, gender they are.
Sure.
But these are main characters, especially in Union Atlantic.
Yes.
It's a main character.
Sure. I mean, I think part of it is, as you say, just that's the task, and you need to just give yourself permission to assume that people have more in common than they have in difference in some sense. But it's also just important women in my own life. I mean, you know, I have a mother, I have a sister, very close female friends. It's just sort of listening and in some sense not assuming that there is a divide. I mean, of course there is, but entering imaginatively and sympathetically into what it is to occupy that place.
Mm-hmm. Do you, given that you, as you said, you're a slow writer, and you know, two novels in a collection of the short stories. Do you prefer the short story form? Because
The short story, you can every morning when you wake up and you write, you can read the entirety of that story. And so when you start to, you know, add to it or complete it, you've got the whole thing held in your mind very presently. Whereas a novel, you can't read 200 pages every morning mm-hmm. before you start the next paragraph.
Right.
And so I think the strain of writing the novel is the trying to hold the whole book in your head for years at a time.
Mm-hmm.
But that said, the forms of discourse you can get at in a novel are it's just much more capacious,
mm-hmm.
Literally and figuratively. So I just they're just different genres. You know, I don't know that I have a preference for
mm-hmm.
one. It really is, as I was saying earlier, there was at the beginning I wondered whether there was part of this that could be a
right.
short story. It's a question of what the material seems to want to be.
Where do you begin? Do you begin with the character or do you begin with the idea for the plot?
No, it's a character.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's always a character and a dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
That they're facing, and I may not even know exactly what the dilemma is, but really, you know, and then when you start to write sentences, the question is, what is the music here? What is the rhythm? What am I finding out? And so there's always sort of, you know, supplies in the closet. I mean, there are things that are, you know, you've been working on, like, bits and pieces, and
mm-hmm.
you look over them, and there's a paragraph, and you think, well, that's sort of interesting amongst the 50 pages you threw out. And then the character kind of builds out of some material that you've got,
mm-hmm.
And then that person is sort of put into a world, you know.
And do you kind of, I think what you're saying, you
yeah.
kind of live with the characters
yeah.
the whole time.
And, yeah.
And which is what you want, because if you're living with them, then the reader
yeah.
is going to live with
no,
them.
No, it's a kind of, I mean, in some ways, I think of it as a kind of method, like method acting.
Uh-huh.
You know, you do, I mean, I have spent time, yeah, living inside them. And so in this case, where there are five different points of view, I would definitely only be working on kind of one chapter at a time, you know, for maybe months,
uh-huh.
Because I was really trying to be inside that mindset.
As a reader,
yeah.
When you read, do you gravitate toward novels or short stories or fiction or nonfiction?
It's all over the map.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's often when I'm writing a novel or fiction, I'm wanting to read more nonfiction
uh-huh.
just because of the, sort of the complexity of what's in my mind. I mean, then again, you know, if it takes 5 years, I certainly
right,
read plenty
right.
of novels
say,
along the way.
Yeah, great.
But usually not when I'm in an intensive writing period.
Uh-huh.
I'm you know reading history or philosophy or something
uh-huh.
Unrelated. But you know, then now because I finished this book a little while ago now. I've just been devouring fiction again because I'm sort of hungry for it. So
uh-huh.
it's a variety, and usually it's what friends have been pressing on me for a while
yeah.
that you know it's finally time to get around to.
So what are some of those books that you've enjoyed?
Well, I mean, so many. I'm trying to think what of late. I went back and reread *The Good Soldier* by
uh-huh.
Ford Madox Ford.
Uh-huh.
I've been reading a bunch of short novels, a novel called Grief by Andrew Halloran,
uh-huh.
The Sense of an Ending by Julian Barnes,
the Ford Madox Ford, the Good Soldier, that's the one that begins. This is the saddest story.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Yes,
and
it's marvelous.
Yeah, and it's one of those, you know, sort of unreliable narrator telling this story that it's actually much like The Sense of an Ending. You get an emotional pull at the beginning, but you don't really know what's happening. You know, he's not
right.
specific, and you've got to kind of muddle through. But the through line is the emotional life of the characters.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, here in this book, there's not plot is not the foreground.
Right.
You're following the mind of the people, and that's, I
right.
think, what... And I was also reading, I should say, the entire time I was writing this book, I was reading all of Proust.
Oh.
So that,
oh.
that was the major fictional
wow.
expedition during the writing of this book.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Are there writers, contemporary writers, your contemporaries? You got an MFA at
yeah.
Iowa Writers Workshop.
That's right, yeah.
Are there writers of your generation that you admire?
Sure.
For their
yeah, well, two who I was in grad school with who I admire greatly. Amity Gage,
mm-hmm.
Whose latest book is Schroeder, came out a couple of years ago,
right.
and also Paul Harding, Tinkers is a wonderful book, and Anon, his second one. So yeah, they're two friends whose work I really admire. Mm-hmm.
Is it hard to read friends' books because you're put in the position of having to admire them, even if you might not? Not that that's ever happened to you.
Yeah, no, sure. I mean, I think the thing is that you, an affinity with a writer is often an affinity with their work. You know what I mean? So a friendship can be born out of admiration for their work. And because there's something that you have in common about what's exciting to you about writing.
There's such an ongoing controversy or discussion about the value of an MFA versus just writing.
Yeah, sure.
Where do you fall on that?
I mean, I think that it's 2 years of time to write, and if you can do it without going into huge amounts of debt, and it seems to be a place that gives you that time. Some places can stack you up with other kind of requirements. Mm-hmm. I think that's the main thing. I think anything else you get from it is sort of gravy. Mm-hmm. The cohort that you move through a program with is out of your control.
Right.
And to some extent,
who's teaching?
Who's teaching, and the teachers are people you may or may not connect with substantively. So, but to give yourself the sort of time to do the work, that's the main thing. And so it can be a structured way to do that.
This is an impossible question, but I'll ask it anyway. Would you have written the same books had you not gotten that MFA?
I think so. I mean, I had been writing before I got there, and I had spent a year at the Fine Arts Work Center in Provincetown, which is a so I had been writing stories and so on. I mean, you know, no doubt I studied with Marilyn Robinson and other people who were great teachers, and so it's hard to say I went a little later, I mean, not that late, but I was maybe 26 or something. I didn't go straight out of undergrad. I mean, if I ran a program, I wouldn't let people in who hadn't had a little time in the world. So, you know.
Did you always know you wanted to be a writer?
No, hardly.
What did you think? A musician?
No. I mean, I don't know that I had very formed thoughts about what I would do. I mean, I sort of, I was dyslexic, so I read slowly and later than most kids. And I just, my first experience with it was just writing in journals when I was, adolescent. I just sort of found the urge to fill journals that I had no concept of doing anything with. And then it wasn't until college that I took a writing class. And then even really for a number of years after that, though I was writing short stories, I didn't think of it as a profession, or I didn't think of myself as writing a book. I mean, it was just it's sort of something I did.
Uh-huh.
And then I decided, okay, I want to give myself some more time to do it.
Yeah.
And that's when I did.
So were you an English major in college?
I was English and philosophy, So, I mean, I was always a reader in that sense. And I think I studied with some great people as professors who I think did imbue in me that love, even in high school as well. I mean, Eugene O'Neill was the first person that I kind of became bewitched by as a writer,
Were you a reader? I mean, given the dyslexia, which made it very hard for you, did you enjoy reading?
Well, it's interesting you should ask that, because it's when people say, oh, you know, this is just sort of a pleasure book, or, you know, something I'm going to take to the beach or whatever. I don't get it, mainly because reading is still, in some sense, I think, an effort. Uh-huh. I mean, it's so frequent now. I mean, obviously in my life, I've never been able to skim. I can't move quickly. A book is like a commitment in a way. So it's a pleasure, but it's not something I can do idly in some sense. I have to be very active. I guess I'm an active reader.
which is the best kind of reader, actually, I think, you know, because you want, I would think, your readers to really
sure, no, no, engage. I love active readers myself,
Right,
you know,
right.
As an author.
As a one, right, right. So you have it good from both ways, on reader right. and writer. I interviewed the mayor of Seattle a few months ago for the show, and he talked about his problems learning to read, and how, despite that difficulty, he grew up as a really active, dedicated, you know, lover of reading.
Yeah. Well, I think it felt, I think, for the reasons that it was more difficult, like an accomplishment. So when I finished a book, it really felt like I had accomplished something. And then I suppose there's some kids, you know, they just read very, very quickly, and they're off reading tens of books,
right.
and it's this disappearance into this imaginative world. And I don't think I had quite that experience, but I also know at some early point, without consciously knowing in a sense, was that I enjoyed individual sentences.
Yeah.
I enjoyed individual sentences and paragraphs that just sounded great and exciting and kind of that spoke to me in a way like a line of poetry would.
Right.
And so, that's when I read even now, I want sentences, you know what I mean? That they're the kind of the unit that is exciting to me as I move through a book.
You mentioned Paul Harding, author of Tinkers, which won the Pulitzer, and that was a book that struck me as being really all about the sentences.
Yes. Yeah. No. Yeah. I mean, you know, right. I love sentences.
Yeah. Yeah.
That rewarding that it's slow reading,
right.
and attention to the rhythm is just very satisfying because I think rhythm is. I want to say almost whether we know it or not, why we fall in love with books. I mean, because you have that experience where you say to someone, you've got to read this book. And they say, well, what's it about? And then you describe the plot and they're like, well, I don't know. You know.
Right.
And you're like, no, but you just have to read it.
Right.
And I think that you just have to read it part is about language and about rhythm and the music of the book.
Right.
And it's what you can't paraphrase, but it's also why you fall in love with a book.
Right. And what makes that book meaningful to you.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think a plot can be meaningful in the same way that, that those sentences can.
Yeah, yeah.
Adam, thank you just so much for talking to me today.
It's a pleasure to talk.
It was, I feel like, you know, we could go on and talk about more
indeed,
things.
Indeed.
But thank you for your new novel, Imagine Me Gone. It just gave me hours of great pleasure reading it.